Professor Dave here, let's talk about NMR spectroscopy.
He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave explains.
So we looked at IR spectroscopy, which once again, spectroscopy is the study of the interaction of light and matter, and we know that we can use that to identify what kind of functional groups might or might not be on a molecule. But that's not going to be good enough, because if we want to do modern synthetic chemistry, which is very complicated, we want to try to be able to build any molecule that we can think of. When we do chemistry, if we do a multi-step synthesis, we have to be sure that every step along the way, and then especially on our final product, we need to know exactly what molecule we have, all of the connectivity, all of the stereochemistry. If we're going to make something complicated, like let's say this molecule, which is called xeranthalide, we need a spectroscopic technique that is going to, we're going to be able to get information on this, on what we think is that compound, and be able to definitively say, yes, it is that molecule, to down to every tiny detail. And that method is nuclear magnetic resonance spectroscopy, or NMR spectroscopy. Now, there's a few different forms. We're going to look at proton NMR, and so the way NMR works, it's just like, it is a form of spectroscopy, so it is the study of interaction of light and matter, but there's a twist here, and it is the case that certain atomic nuclei exhibit nuclear spin, and we can take advantage of that nuclear spin by by subjecting a molecule to an external magnetic field, and when we do that, we're going to be able to get some very interesting data when we then get spectroscopic data from it. So that is, we induce a magnetic field, and then we irradiate with light, and we gather information about how the light interacts with that compound. So without getting too into the physics of it all, we're just understanding that we're looking at proton NMR involving protium. These are protium nuclei. So protium, which is a hydrogen isotope of mass 1, as opposed to deuterium or tritium. And what happens is, we're going to be able to irradiate this with light and then get back information that tells us the precise chemical environment of every single proton in this molecule. And we can use that information to discern the precise structure of the molecule. So let's take a look at one of these spectra and talk about how we can interpret them. So what I've done here is I've drawn a sample NMR spectrum, and we're going to talk about the three main pieces of data that we are going to try to glean from any NMR spectrum. So once again, we're doing this, this is going to be a very simple example. We're not going to get too in depth, but just in a very basic way, what can we get from an NMR spectrum? So first of all, what is going on here? So right here, we have a reference peak. This is called TMS, that's tetramethyl silane, and then everything else is given in parts per million in terms of where it stands in reference to the TMS. So this is our reference peak, so that's not data, that's going to be on any spectrum, and then this stuff, this is the data. Okay, so how is this data? How are we interpreting these peaks, these resonances? Well, there's three things that we want to take into account for any resonance on a spectrum. That is going to be the chemical shift, the integration, and the splitting. So what do these three things mean? Let's talk about them one at a time. So chemical shift, all chemical shift means is, where is it? Where is it on this spectrum? Is it more downfield, or is it more upfield? Now, what this has to do with is it tells us about the chemical environment of a particular proton. Remember that these are protons that are generating these resonances. So in a molecule, anywhere where there is a hydrogen atom, you are getting some information about the chemical environment of that hydrogen atom or that proton. So what happens is, the closer that that proton is to some electronegative element, the electronegative atom is going to have a deshielding effect. So because of its electronegativity, it is going to withdraw the electron density of that proton away from the nucleus, which we call a deshielding effect, right? Because the electrons are moving away from the nucleus, and then that will cause that signal to be more downfield. So more downfield means closer to electronegative atoms, and this means upfield means farther away from electronegative elements. So, number one, the chemical shift is telling us about the chemical environment. That means where is it on the spectrum? This way is closer to electronegative elements. This is further away from electronegative elements. Number two is integration. So let's say that we have some chemically equivalent protons. That might be three protons on the same methyl group. As they're spinning around, they see the same thing as they look down the rest of the molecule. They are experiencing an identical chemical environment. So what ends up happening is, let's say we have one proton on that methyl group that generates this resonance, this generates this information right here, then that second proton also generates the same resonance, so that just enhances this peak and it will get bigger. And then that third proton also generates the exact same resonance or the exact same data, so that too will cause this to grow. And what that means is, this is an integration. So integration literally means the area under the curve. So this is NMR spectra don't look exactly like this. This is an oversimplified view of it. But whatever data is happening under that peak, the integration means the area under the curve. So we can just consider it to be kind of how tall is it, or how big is the resonance. And so that's the second bit of information, is the integration. The integration is telling us how many chemically equivalent protons are generating that peak. So if this is integrated to 2 and this is integrated to 3, then what we're saying is that 2 chemically equivalent protons are making that one, and 3 are making that one. So that's integration. That's saying how many protons are generating that peak. Now, the last thing we want to talk about is splitting. And so chemically equivalent protons will generate the same resonance, but then that resonance will be split into a certain number of smaller peaks depending on neighboring protons. And so what we want to understand is so this is about neighboring protons, and this is the N plus 1 rule. And so basically what we're saying is, let's say we have a hydrogen that is generating some resonance. It's generating some resonance, but then if there is a neighboring proton, that acts like a little magnet. So let's say we're looking at a proton one carbon over, and that proton will split this one into 2 resonances. Okay, now let's say that there's a second neighboring proton. That will split this into 2 resonances, and this into 2 resonances. So we'll have an overlap there, and that one will be more intense. This middle one will be more intense. And so that's why we see something like this. We have the middle one is the longest. But at any rate, we are seeing that an individual resonance that is generated by one proton will be split into a series of smaller peaks by neighboring protons. And so specifically, it will be split into N plus 1 peaks, where N is the number of neighboring protons. So if we have some chemically equivalent protons with, let's say, 2 protons next door, it will be split into 3 peaks, or a triplet. So this is called a triplet. This would be called a quartet. We could have a singlet. We could have a doublet. So that's splitting. That is telling us the number of neighboring protons. So those are the three bit of data. So now let's look at the structure of what this actually is. What this actually is bromoethane, and let's assign the peaks. So what we need to understand is that we have two different resonances to expect, because these two protons are chemically equivalent. Usually the protons on the same carbon are chemically equivalent. And then we have 3 that are chemically equivalent over here. So let's look at this one first. We're saying that these are 3 of them, so we better have it integrated to 3. So it's probably going to be this peak. In addition, it's further away from the bromine, so it should be more upfield. And then it's going to be split by the 2 neighboring protons into a triplet, because 2 plus 1 is a triplet. So we have a triplet that is integrated to 3 that is more upfield, so this peak certainly corresponds to B. Then looking at A, we're saying that we need to look for a peak that, number 1, is integrated to 2 because there are 2 protons. Also, it should be further upfield because it's closer to the bromine atom. The bromine atom is going to deshield those protons. So that's further upfield. And then additionally, the 3 neighboring protons, 3 plus 1 is 4. It should be split into a quartet. by those neighboring protons. So this certainly is going to be A. So just to reiterate, we have chemical shift. Where is it sitting on the spectrum? We have integration. How tall is it, more or less, which refers to the number of protons that are generating that resonance. And then the splitting pattern, which tells us how many neighboring protons there are. Okay, let's look at one more sample spectrum to make sure that we can assign these NMR spectra. So let's say we're looking at this compound and we want to match the protons to the peaks that they correspond to. This is probably going to be something you'll do in any organic chemistry course. You'll be given a compound and a spectrum, and the problem will say match the protons to the peaks they correspond to. So first of all, let's make sure we understand where the protons are, right? So we've got three there. We've got two there, and we've got three there. We definitely have to be able to do that, otherwise this is going to be extremely difficult. Now, we know that for the most part, at least at this early stage of analyzing NMR spectra, let's just say that all the protons on an individual carbon are going to be chemically equivalent. Because let's say we've got these three protons on this methyl. As this bond is rotating, right, there's no spatial differentiation. It doesn't matter if one's down or up or whatever. As they spin around like a top, they're all seeing the same chemical environment. So these are all the same, let's call them A. These two are the same, let's call them B. These three are the same, let's call them C. Now, one very good method, either we could just try to assign straight off the bat, but first, just to be a little more thorough, let's make predictions about what we could expect from each resonance. So looking at A first, we know that this is going to be integrated to 3, right? We know it's going to be integrated to 3 because there are 3 protons. Okay, then let's talk about splitting. There are no neighboring hydrogens. There are no neighboring hydrogens, so it will not be split at all. We are expecting a singlet here. And then lastly, this we expect it to be relatively upfield because it is near a carbonyl carbon. Now, if we want to be very specific with our predictions, we could consult a table that would tell us the exact ppm to expect for hydrogens next to a given functional group or whatever it is. So we may not even really need to, though, because we have plenty of information here. This is a very simple molecule. There's only 3 peaks, so this is going to be enough. A 3H singlet that is relatively upfield. That's plenty of information. Then over here, we know that there's 2 hydrogens, so we expect that resonance is going to be integrated to 2, because there are 2 of them. And then we expect it to be split into a quartet, because there are 3 neighboring hydrogens. So here's the hydrogens we're talking about. The neighboring ones are right here. There's 3 of them, and so 3 plus 1 gives us 4, a quartet. There are no hydrogens over here. That's an oxygen. So a 2H quartet that should be, again, relatively upfield, because these are adjacent to an oxygen atom. An oxygen atom is very electronegative. It has a lot of electron withdrawing capability. So those should be relatively deshielded and relatively upfield protons, or the resonance that corresponds to those protons. Then lastly, right here, we've got 3 chemically equivalent protons. So we should expect a peak integrated to 3. We should expect that it is split into a triplet because we have 2 neighboring hydrogens. So N is 2, N plus 1 is 3. So this resonance should be split into 3 smaller peaks, or a triplet. And then we should expect that it is relatively, you know what, I think I mixed up. What I meant was downfield here. And upfield. This should be relatively upfield because it is not near any electron withdrawing group. So it is relatively shielded. It will stay relatively upfield. So we have a 3H triplet upfield. So now this is going to be very easy to assign, right? Because so let's say here we have a 3H triplet upfield. Well, this is integrated to 3. It is a triplet and it is upfield. So this is certainly resonance C. Here we have a 2H quartet downfield. So here it's integrated to 2, it's a quartet, it's downfield, that's got to be B. And then we have A, we have a 3H singlet that is may or may not be downfield, it's right there in the middle. And so that is certainly going to be peak A. So once again, when we are looking at a molecule and we are trying to assign resonances to the protons that they correspond to, we are going to be looking at 3 things. We're looking at chemical shift, we're looking at integration, and we're looking at splitting. And all we need to do is get enough data to be able to assign those peaks accordingly. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.